Webinar is being recorded. Great. So we'll get started. Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining today's Jenkins online meetup. Our session today is on Jenkins in Google Summer of Code. We're focusing on coding midterm demos. Slide. All right. My name is Alyssa Tong, and I'm one of the org admins for this year's GSoC. Also on the call are our other org admins, Jean-Marc Mason, Chris Stern, and Bruno Verachten. Before we begin, just a couple of housekeeping items. Jenkins Online Meetup is a community-driven online platform. Our goal is to inform, transfer knowledge, and share all things Jenkins. We are always looking for speakers. So if you have a compelling Jenkins story to share with us, please do reach out via the looking for speakers link here. Next slide. There we go. So as I mentioned earlier, this session is being recorded and we will share the recording link after the event. So later on today. If you have any questions, please put your questions in the chat window. Our presenters and mentors will respond to them throughout the presentation. And of course, lastly, the Jenkins code of conduct is fully enforced on this channel and throughout the community. If you're not sure what that's about, take a look at the elephant and the cat picture and basically being respectful and kind to one another. So Jean-Marc?
Great. So I will lead this session here. So I'm going to do a very small introduction what GSoC is, and especially Jenkins in GSoC. We're going to follow the following format. Every participant will present his project and probably do a demo of his project in 10 minutes, and we will keep 5 minutes just after his presentation for Q&A question. And then we'll move to the next contributor. So this is a format we're going to use. Next slide. So Google Summer of Code is a program organized by Google, sponsored by Google to promote participation in open source programming. And to train new contributors to open source. Next slide. So this is the 7th year that we're participating. We have 4 projects that have been selected in between more than 60 proposals. And 4 projects and contributors have been selected. Check out the main page referenced on the slide, where you'll have details on the program and contributors participating to this year's program. And you will have also a lot of indication how to prepare for next year's edition. You can also review last year's participation and see what great stuff has been contributed to the Jenkins community. So we'll start the presentations. These are the 4 contributors that participate this year. And we'll start with Jagruti's contribution, so the first 6 weeks of participation, what she's already done, and I think she has great stuff to present. Jagruti, the floor is yours.
Hey, Jagruti, you can start sharing.
Yes. Yeah, I'm sharing this. Okay, my screen is shared.
Yes, we see your screen.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Jagruti. And for this GSoC, I'm working on add probes to plugin health score project. My lovely mentors are Adrian, Dheeraj, Jake, Antoine, and Pierre. You can have a look at the project in this website. My agenda for this presentation would be that I would start with explaining about the plugin health score project. I will then introduce myself. I will speak of the three probes that I've worked on in the first part, that is unreleased production changes probe, third-party repository detection probe, security scan workflow probe. And then I will also speak about what I want to do in the second half of the GSoC and what I will do in that part. So what is plugin health score project all about? As we all know, that Jenkins is around a two-decade-old project, and a project that is as mature and as large as Jenkins is, we require active contribution from both the maintainers and the contributors. It is important that the maintainers and the contributors invest their time in a correct, in a plugin that is, which is like what we can say, useful to others, which is not obsolete. So plugin health score project actually collects data about different plugins and rates them according to their quality. A higher quality probe will have a higher score, and obsolete or outdated plugin will have a lower score. So why did I choose this project? Apart from the reason that this project was one of the accepted Jenkins GSoC project, I also noticed that there are many probes existing in the project. They do give insightful data, but they do not cover all the criteria. There are many criteria that I could cover. So that is what I proposed in my GSoC proposal. That is why I picked this project. A little bit about me. I am a senior product engineer and I have around 4.5 years of experience. I got promoted 3 months ago. So I'm also responsible for around 3 people in my team recently. So apart from learning coding, I'm also learning about mentoring people from my mentors as well. This project is really a great fit for me because I was not really interested in learning a new library, or you can say a new library or something new to implement, but I was much more interested in digging deeper into what I already know. And this project gives me just that. I'm grateful to the Jenkins community for selecting me. I'm also fortunate to have 5 active mentors that give me different perspective and how can I do better in my project. This is the first probe I worked on, that is unreleased production changes probe. It happens so that many a times we already have different production changes, different code that is already fixed, like there are bug fixes, there can be new features and security fixes. They are ready, but they are not released actually to the production. And there's no use if something is fixed and not released. It is important in the perspective for the developers to collect feedback and also the users to use and what we can say, an updated and live version. So this probe actually detects if there are any undelivered bug fixes, or it highlights that, okay, this feature is stale and there's an update, but it is not delivered yet. And if the features and the bugs are not delivered, that means the probe might have an inactive maintainer and might need adoption. So the details are that this probe in the code actually does is identify that, okay, this is a production code that has not been delivered yet. And we identify it and we give that information in the probe, in the list, like we deliver a list of files that are not released yet. And a good thing that I can share about this probe, and this is my first GSoC probe that went live into production. The challenges that I faced is really interesting here because I find this probe a little difficult to tackle for 2 reasons, because I did not have a really good knowledge of Git hierarchy, and also the JGit API was new. So both their combination, I think, made it a little difficult for me to tackle. But thanks to my mentors, I was able to overcome it successfully. I also learned about writing unit test cases. And there's a trivial data about learning IntelliJ shortcuts, but I mentioned it because it really helped me in the long run when I was working on other groups. The fun part is I had a pair programming session with the mentors. Now, I did not know how fun it was for the mentors, but it was really fun for me because I don't really have someone telling me that, hey, Jagruti, you can do this better, or you should write it this way, you should use this shortcut, and they not type it exactly. But that's what I learned with my mentors. So yeah, that was interesting to me. Okay, so this probe is exciting to me because this is a community requested probe. When I was reading the details, I saw that the Jenkins infra team usually gets a request from a plugin maintainer that this build is failing. And they say that, okay, this third-party repository wasn't helping the build. So Jenkins infra team has to do it manually again. So with this probe, they can add the repositories in the build at the first time itself. Also, this Maven collect gathers dependencies from different repository, and it is important that the repositories are reliable and secure. We also have a default Jenkins repository, but this does not mean that always all the dependencies will be collected from a same repository. So this probe actually gives the user an idea that these are the third-party plugins that are used, because the plugins might break future build, they may cause licensing or security issues. So it is usually great to be aware about it. In this probe, one of the biggest challenges that I faced was identifying all the different parent and child relationships, along with test scenarios, which is a common challenge which I usually face because I'm not really aware of writing test cases. So this probe is actually partially complete, I would say around 60%. The reason is we thought that, okay, this probe is almost done. And during the review and test cases writing process, we found that there are a lot of assumptions we made about Maven project hierarchy. And there were a lot of edge cases that we had left. So until we get a good idea about the edge cases, what we have to work on and we tackle them, we've decided to put this probe on hold. Though we have a solution in mind is to write an effective effective POM file actually, which will be a whole service that will get effective POM using the different Maven hierarchies. In this probe, I learned writing parameterized test cases. Important thing was learning POM structure inheritance. I went through the original documentation and Maven API. Okay, so this is the third probe that I was working on. It is GitHub security scan workflow. As we all know that digital world is actually vulnerable to attacks. And that is why our Jenkins security team has configured GitHub Actions, which scans the source codes as soon as it is committed into the continuous integration thing. And it is also considered a good practice by the community, Jenkins community, that we take care of security and we scan things as and when we are progressing. So this is what this scan probe encourages. It makes sure that the security scan is configured in GitHub workflow directory. It emphasizes on security and it makes sure that the security part is configured correctly. Okay, in this probe, I had challenges, but most of the challenges were refactoring the classes. There was code duplication in continuous delivery probe and security scan workflow probe. So I had to refactor a class that avoids duplication, and I had to take an existing contribution from a contributor. This probe is under review, and I learned in this probe about the Git branch rebasing, writing unit test cases, and how to benefit from different class hierarchy. Okay, I'm excited to announce.
You have 2 minutes to wrap up.
Okay, I'm excited to announce that. Okay, no problem. I'm excited to announce that in the second half of the GSoC, I'm going to work on a renovate board probe that will detect if a plugin is using a renovate board. This is similar to using a dependent board. I will also work on a probe that will count the number of open tickets in the plugin. And then I will also work on a probe that will say that, okay, your plugin POM is not updated to the latest Jenkins plugin POM, and many more things. I'm also going to design the scoring system for the probes that I have completed, which I have not started yet. And I will also write blogs to document each of the probes that I have done. Next, what I want to learn is designing classes and methods using the OOPS concept from scratch, which I usually don't get a chance to do at all. And I also want to write integration test cases. So do you have any questions now?
That was nicely on time, Jagruti. Congratulations. So open Thank for you. Questions. Chris or Bruno, do we have questions in the Q&A channel?
I can't see any question for something or even something written in the chat.
Okay, we'll wait for a little time.
Are you okay, John Mark, if the rest of us ask questions?
You're most welcome.
Okay, so Jagruti, as a new contributor, were there things that you found were barriers to you? Things that, oh, I wish I'd known that, or I wish that other thing had happened differently. I'm interested in finding ways we can reduce barriers to new contributors.
By barriers, you mean in working with the project or?
Yes, so in interacting with Jenkins development and doing work in an area that was probably not your immediate, oh, I'm super strong in this skill already, something that was new to you.
Okay, so let me tackle this. See, when I started, I thought that, okay, GSoC would be like easy, I would be able to do it. It might be really easy for me. But as soon as I worked on my first group, let me tell you, it wasn't easy at all. Like I said about JGit and Git hierarchy, I think as a new contributor, whoever is contributing to the project, they should have a lot of background information about Jenkins and about different functionalities that we use. Only that is one thing that might make their journey easier. And since I did not know everything, so I took some time in learning things that way.
Thank you. Thanks very much. So more information about Jenkins and how to use it. More information about, sounds like JGit and Git were important to you, and certainly they're important to me. So that fits. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Keep the mic open for questions from the Q&A chat or direct questions. Bruno, no questions on the chat?
No questions yet, no.
Okay, then I see a question raised hands, I think from a participant.
Yes.
So this is a special Zoom meeting where attendees cannot speak. So you're invited to type your questions in the Q&A panel. So we'll have 2 minutes.
We're also actively monitoring the chat panel. So Q&A is the better choice. It's certainly the best choice to ask the question.
Okay, I don't see. We're going to see if we can catch these questions in a way or the other and answer to them later, either in this session or in another session.
If we still have some time.
Oh. Okay,
right. I'll
give you
says,
a minute and a half. Yep.
I'm studying DevOps tools and I want to contribute, but I don't know the way. Oh, it's a general question, not to Jagruti, I guess. Mark, would you like to answer?
Sure, there's a web page, jenkins.io/participate. That offers 10 or 15 different alternatives of ways you could contribute. Also, the Gitter chat channel for newcomer contributors, if you want to explore very specific ways. Maybe you're interested in Java, maybe JavaScript, maybe like Jagruti's project, you're interested in something that will help the infrastructure or help users assess things. Maybe like other projects, you're interested in documentation, all of them wide open, and that participate page is exactly the place to go.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, Mark.
I'm sorry. Thank you for your answer and for the tips, Mark, but we need to move on. Otherwise, we run out of time there. Jagruti, thank you very much for your presentation. and the answer. Can I ask you to
thank you for listening?
To cut your sharing and give it so that Alyssa can take it back.
I'm sharing right now, Jean-Marc.
Okay, got you. Waiting for the slides to load, and the next one to speak, it shows loading.
Is that the same for everybody? Because for me, it's showing Harsh's page.
It is loading. Loading for me.
Oh. Loading.
Same for me.
It shows a Google Doc document.
It's not showing it to me.
Go ahead and share again, Alyssa.
Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah, it worked this time. Thank you.
There. Okay. There. So next one. Harsh, are you there? Okay, good. The floor is yours then.
Hi, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you are. This is the GitLab plugin modernization project under Google Summer of Code 2023. I am Harsh Pratap Singh, and my mentors are Mark, Basil, Kristen, and Freya Mehta. Next slide, please. So a bit more about me. I am Harsh, and I'm an open source enthusiast from India. My interests lie in different computer science fields like DevOps and blockchain and some other non-technical fields like economics, philosophy, and many more interesting stuff. Currently, I'm an undergrad at Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur, and I started contributing to Jenkins from February, and I got hooked since then. You can check me out. Next slide, please. So let me give you a bit of a technical brief about the project. So GitLab is a fast-growing modern DevSecOps platform that has evolved quite a lot in past years. But unfortunately, Jenkins couldn't keep up with it. Thus, here comes the GitLab plugin modernization project for helping the community. So what is the GitLab plugin about? The GitLab plugin enables seamless interaction between Jenkins and GitLab. So what is this project about? The project is about replacing the usage of very, very old REST EC library with GitLab 4j API via GitLab API plugin in the Jenkins library. So why is this project required? This project will greatly reduce the maintenance issues that we can have in the future, will make the plugin more lightweight as GitLab 4j requires much less manual dependencies, will improve the consistency with other Jenkins plugins, and also most importantly, improve the documentation. Now, how was this going to be happening? Let's see, this is what the project and the presentation aims to convey. So next slide, please. What has happened in the coding phase one? So I was just a 2-month-old programmer when I started contributing to Jenkins, and it has been a great experience. So I learned quite a lot in this phase, like Git, GitHub, and most importantly, GitLab. I did extensive debugging even inside some Docker containers. I improved my knowledge on Java. I learned a lot about Java building, Spotworks, and other Java toolings. I also learned about functional testing using JUnit, Mockito, and other Docker-based testing. But what has happened? What did you do after learning all these things? So I completed a migration from RESTEZ to GitLab 4j API via the GitLab API plugin, and we as a mentoring team have successfully tested the migrated plugin interactively. So next slide, please. But what has changed? If the plugin was so old, something must have changed, right? So migration should be like a magic, but like ideally it should be, but it's not. So over the years, GitLab has evolved a lot. And thus during the migration, we found out that the plugin was supporting the version 3, which GitLab does not support currently. And so I am using this presentation as a medium to convey that all the users that are using the version 3 of the GitLab API should be switching to GitLab API version 4 as soon as possible. And for more information, you can also refer to the references that we'll be having later. The minimum GitLab version for this plugin, the updated plugin, will be 14.0, and the minimum Jenkins version will be the 2.387.3. Next slide, please. So let's see if it works or not live. Let me share my screen. So is this visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so yes, I am using a GitLab.com production server here, and I'll be using a Jenkins Docker instance. So I'll be making a change, like I'll be committing a change, and let's see if the freestyle job gets triggered or not. I have already set up the configuration and the compatibility between my development release of the GitLab plugin and my Jenkins. And let's see if the GitLab sample job is working or not. So yeah, you can see it has started its work. Let's see if the console output is perfect or not. Going on. It will take up a bit of a time because I've created a lot of things. And it's doing its checkout. Yep, it's a connection success. So everything worked as we wanted it to be. Let's see the changes. And here is the commit that I made just for this thing. So let's go back to the slides. So yeah, journey ahead, excited about it. It seems to be working. So the following things that I'll be doing in the second coding phase, I'll be adapting the webhooks to the GitLab 4j API events. This is a work in progress currently. I'll also be migrating the proxy settings and adapting the tests. I am currently adapting the tests. It's also a work in progress. Of course, I'll be improving the documentation. It's the most important thing for me. And I and my mentoring team are going to do extensive testing so that the community does not face any problems. And ideally the migration should feel like magic, right? So next slide, please. Here are some references if you are more curious about the project. You can learn more about the project through the project page. You can join us for the project discussions in the GitHub channel. You can also refer to the project notes, and maybe you can join us on project meetings also from this link. And if you want to file a request or if you have an issue with the things which we are doing right now, you also have the GitHub repository link for doing that. Next slide, please. So thank you, especially to my lovely mentors, the supportive community, and for your patient listening. Next slide, please. So if you have any questions, you're free to ask now.
That was great presentation, Harsh, and especially that you finished on time. So that's great stuff. Congratulations, dear. So are there any questions? Don't hesitate if you have questions to write them either in the Q&A or the chat. If people in the panel will also want to ask questions, they can go ahead.
So Harsh, you noted that you were a very, very new programmer. A very new programmer, what sorts of things helped you get started? What were things where you might suggest as others start their development journey, what sorts of things did you find helpful? What things did you find hindering?
When we learn programming, we are mostly making our projects, which is very comfortable. Like we learn some technology and make a project on its own. But when we start contributing to open source, it is a completely new arena where we are stepping in. And you need a lot of help from people. So don't shy away asking help. Also, start having a habit of reading documentation manually. It has helped me quite a lot. Improve on your Googling skills. That's underrated, but it helps a lot. And research is a part of software engineering, according to my experience, like a very small experience that I have. And it just goes fine. Be optimistic and be hardworking. Perseverance here is the key, and consistency is very important.
So, but you asked some questions, weren't there awkward times when you felt like you were asking a question that someone might have thought was obvious? Or how do you overcome your concern? Oh, but I might feel silly, or I might feel badly that I asked a question that was so obvious to everyone else. How do you deal with that?
It is research. Like whenever you ask a question, you should have researched quite a lot about it. Either it is a difficult question for someone who you were even asking, or the person is quite experienced to know that it is obvious. If you're asking someone a question and the person who is answering feels it's obvious, that means you are asking the question from a right guy. And if you're able to ask the question from a very experienced person, that means you have researched quite a lot. Because if you ask some random question like how to do this, nobody will be able to help you. You must be having detailed questions so that people could help you. So don't shy away, be shameless.
Great attitude.
Very wise. Thank you. And I liked the Google is your friend part. So sharpen your Google skill, Google or whatever other search engine. Are there other questions, Bruno? Something on
nothing
the chat?
Nothing to be Q&A? Seen yet. No, I can't see anything. Okay. Don't be shy. Do like harsh. Ask questions.
Okay, I propose that we...
There's a question, Mark. I'm sorry, Jean-Marc. I'm sorry.
Move on.
Jean-Marc, go just ahead, 30 then. Seconds for a second for a question. Aaron Conaway asks, sorry for your name, what went wrong, Harsh? And what was the most frustrating part?
For me personally, the most frustrating part were the tests because they were so damn old. Like, I first tried to adapt them and I came to a conclusion that they're very old. Then I thought of improving them by making some changes, but they still were too old. So we are currently trying to find some solutions for making it more modern using the test containers that we are discussing it right now. But as the tests were so old, it was actually kind of a liability because we couldn't use it for testing whether the production code is correct or not. So yeah, that's one frustration that I have with the project.
Okay, that was a good tip.
Aaron says other a lesson questions? In technical debt. Yeah. No, I can't see any other question, just a comment from Aaron, lesson in technical debt. Yeah. Thank you, Aaron.
Okay. Thank you very much for this interesting question. We're going to move on to the next contributor. So, Vandit, you're on a row and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jean-Marc. Hi, everyone. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon. Wherever you are, I hope you all are doing well. So here we are discussing about the project, discussing about my project, which is building Jenkins.io with alternative tools. And the mentors, the people who really helped me are Mark Waite, Chris Chan, Yuming Wong, and Rajiv Singh. Next slide, please. Before moving on, I think it would be nice if you guys know something about me. Yeah, awesome. So my name is Vandit and I'm a computer science undergraduate from India. My journey with Jenkins started in July 2022, where I began contributing to Jenkins. And as a beginner, you always take the hardest tasks to do and you fail at it quite gloriously. So I did that and I learned that I still have to learn more. So I stuck around and I contributed some more. So this was how my journey with Jenkins started. My interests are DevOps, web development, and building things particularly. I love open source because it will take over proprietary software in the near future, and we all love open source for that. If you want to connect with me, those are where you can DM me or send me a hi. I love talking to strangers. Next slide, please. Before we go on, I would like to put light on the things we will be discussing today. We'll start with the project description, the things I did and what was planned and what changed, because when you are making a project, some things change while making it. And then we'll get on the demo and I'll take your questions after that. Next slide, please. Yeah, so my project is building Jenkins.io with alternative tools. As the name suggests, the currently hosted Jenkins.io site is made with Ostruct, which is heavily under maintained because the last commit it had was 2 years back. So that's why we are migrating to two new tools, Entora and Gatsby, because using an under-maintained software can be quite damaging to the documentation and to the users of Jenkins. So why are we using Entora and Gatsby? The main goal was implementing versioning in the documentation. And since Ostruct was taking its last breaths, you can say, So it was the correct time to move to Entora, which provides versioning by default out of the box, due to which we'll be able to provide version documentations to the user of Jenkins. Now, since Jenkins.io hosts many type of documentations, user documentation, developer documentation, we'll currently only version the documentation, user documentation and solutions and tutorials, because developer documentation remains the same throughout the years. We are using Gatsby for the rest of the site expect documentation, because Gatsby is fast and Gatsby is secure, and who does not like being fast when you are building a site? Next slide, please. So the things I have done till now are, I have completed the user documentation, developer documentation, tutorials, and the guides. The solution page is still under progress, and I'm currently working on it since it has a different layout than all the other pages. So that's what I'm still working on. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah, what was planned? When we started working on the project, it was planned that we will generate the entire site with Entora. Expect the YML files and the blog section will be generated by Gatsby. But since we are in open source and community feedback is really important for us, so we asked the community what do they think about it. So what they said will be next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, so you can find the discussion on what the community said. But now what the community suggested and what we are going with will be, Entora should only be used for the versioning part, and only documentation should be built with it. And Gatsby and Strapi CMS will be used for the rest of the site. Because that entirety of the Jenkins.io is documentation, so Gatsby still has to do some less work. But yeah, we'll be using Gatsby for the entire site now. And also the YML files will still be built with Gatsby. Next slide, please. The issues we faced, because when you are building things, we face issues. How Ostruct Intel uses interpage linking is completely different from how Entora uses it. So I'm still working on removing the how Ostruct does that and implementing how Entora does it. So that is a great issue that I'm facing currently and still working on it. The data table API is used on some pages on Jenkins.io to show some information about the repositories. So that was not working. It was due to some jQuery issue. Kristen helped me with it a lot. So thanks, Chris. And extension index page has a search functionality that is still in the to-do list, because I'm currently in the process to able to figure it out. And after that, in the tutorial sections, there were a lot of pages that were just redirecting to the same pages in that directory. So we removed them because they were not redirecting, and Entora does not provide anything related to redirecting. Next slide, please. Yeah, so now going on with the demo, I'll share my screen. So currently we are hosting the site on GitHub workflow on GitHub pages. So this is the site that I have made till now. It contains developer documentation, plugin tutorials, and the guides and the reference documentation. You can see here we have the user documentation. It is version, and as you can see here, I did this page. There will be a drop down in this site, but since we only have the latest documentation now, so I can't show it now. But since after this project completes, we'll be able to see documentation versions of documentation that we can switch, and we are still using the header and footer from the old Jenkins.io, because these are used across all the sites. from here we can see that we have developer documentation, which is a non-version. So it is just showing default because it is non-version. That Jenkins tutorial, we have Jenkins tutorials which are versioned, as I said. When we'll have more versions of the documentation, we'll be able to see a drop down from where we can change the documentation. And I'm still working on the solutions page. It currently looks like this, but it's still under progress. So I don't think so. It's really great to show things that are not complete. But yeah, I have changed the UI. I have improved the UI and UX with having continuous discussion with my mentors to make the Jenkins.io site more user friendly and people can find the documentation easily. So yeah, that was all for the demo. Let's get back to the slides. Yeah, the future plans. Next slide, please. The future plans are complete the rest of the work in the documentation site, fix interpage linking, solutions page. And after that, the solutions page layout is entirely different from all the other documentation pages. So that is something I'll be doing. And after that, I'll start working on the blogs and the rest of the site pages like security, advisories, change logs, and download page. Next slide, please. I'm open for questions. Throw them at me.
Thank you very much for that great presentation, Vandit. So it looks very, very interesting and promising. Bruno, are there any questions?
Not yet.
Any questions on the panel?
So creating a replacement for a thing that's existed for many years, I would think is incredibly difficult because of all the things that are happening inside it. The Jenkins.io site has lots of things going on. What have you done to discover all the things that are being generated there, and how are you learning what's happening with them? Or have you just narrowed your focus and said, no, we're just going to focus on a subset?
Things I learned about Jenkins.io was when I was contributing last year. I looked around a lot in the repository structure, and that's how I know some things. I already had some knowledge about how Jenkins.io works. Most of the sections I knew, most of the larger sections, how does them work, and that really helped me in migrating the entirety of the site. That is really helping me in migrating the entirety of the site. Because when I contributed, I solved a lot of issues related to documentation, how things were building, some JavaScript issues. So that was how I got the knowledge, and that is I'm using while building the project.
I just would like to add here that the contribution that Vandit did, and nearly all contributors in this session, made the last part of last year were important preparation for what I call building the Jenkins muscle. So to know and to situate where things are and how to contribute, this helps you to make a powerful proposal. And as a chance. Sorry, I have a lot of noise here around me. I apologize if it comes through.
We can't hear it, Mark. You're good.
No questions yet, if that was your next question, Jean-Marc.
So were there complications that you found in preparing yourself for Google Summer of Code or in preparing your proposal? Are there things that you'd like to share with others about, hey, this is, I learned this, be sure you don't forget that?
Yeah, when I made my first proposal, because I made two, and the first project was withdrawn, but since that project was really interesting and I researched about it a lot, but after that dropped, I was bit down, but I knew that I had to do this because when I was contributing, that at that time I found out about GSoC, and it was like, since I have contributed and I have the knowledge, I can make up a new proposal, and I did. So when you are like learning for when you're aiming for GSoC, I would say contribute as much as you can. When as her said, you should ask detailed questions. Also put the research you did in the questions, and those are the things that really helped me. And always know that anything can go wrong, but don't get depressed when things go wrong. You can just if you have contributed, you have the knowledge, you can do it again.
Thank you for these insights.
Yeah,
Bruno,
if
you can't tell me if there are any questions.
No questions, Jean-Marc. And I think Vandit had a few things to say to conclude.
Yeah. While concluding, I'll say if you are interested in the project, you can come to the Gitter channel. That's where we talk regularly about the project. You can find the meeting notes. That's where we track everything on a weekly basis. And the GitHub repositories that we are using to migrate are Jenkins Docs and Jenkins UI project. And the project plan can be found on the GitHub wiki of Jenkins Docs. Next slide, please. So yeah, that's all. Thank you for being a great audience.
Thank you to you, Vandit. So we'll move on now to the next presentation.
Go ahead, Bruno. Interruption. Alisa, where will we be able to find the slide afterward? Because I saw that some contributors were sharing some links in their presentation, but the attendees can't click on them yet.
Yeah, so I will share the slides in the Meetup, on the Meetup page under the comments section. So that's where I put the links to the recording as well as the link to the slide.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Very good question for the logistics of this presentation. Still doing the timekeeping over here. Ashutosh is now the last in the row and was very, very patient and probably very nervous waiting for his turn. Ashutosh, the floor is yours now.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I am Ashutosh. My project is Docker-based Jenkins Quickstart examples. Next slide, please. Let's see what's the problem this project aims to solve. Next slide, please. Let's imagine you have a friend who wants to see what Jenkins is about and try it out. He's curious about Jenkins and wants to try it out. You tell them that Docker is the best way to try Jenkins locally and lead them to the Docker documentation for installing Jenkins. Let's see how their first experience with Jenkins is going to look like. First, in the with the documentation, they'll have to create a network with this Docker command. Then they'll have to create a Docker in Docker container with this scary looking Docker command with a lot of arguments. And Jenkins is not even started yet. Next slide, please. Then they'll have to build a custom Docker image with a Docker file with this command. Then they'll have to run that custom image with this scary looking command with this many arguments. And after everything is done, the setup is running, the setup is still not perfect because this setup runs the job on the controller itself, which is a security risk. And the Docker in Docker comes with its own security risks. Another problem is this setup have a lot of intimidating steps for beginner user and not user friendly. Another problem is that right now on Jenkins.io, we have tutorials for users to get familiar with Jenkins that uses the same setup with these Docker commands. Next slide, please. Let's see how are we solving these issues. Next slide, please. So for the intimidating steps part, we are using Docker Compose to hide all the complexities of the Docker commands. And we are using scripts to automate the running of the Jenkins containers. We have created two scripts, Jenkins init.sh and Jenkins teardown.sh. After cloning the repository files, the user only needs to run Jenkins init.sh script, and every step for starting the containers will be automatic. And after the tutorial has been completed and the work with Jenkins is completed, the user can use the teardown script to clear everything that the init command started. Next slide, please. So this solves the first issue. The second issue of security risk of running jobs on the controller. For this, we are using separate containers for controller and agents. We are using multi-container setup with Docker Compose. And we are using another script, keygen.sh, that creates and updates the SSH keys for connecting the container to agent. Docker Compose files are configured with new SSH keys every time the init script is ran. Next, please. What about the other tutorials? As I mentioned earlier, we are using these same Docker commands in the tutorials that are aimed towards beginners to learn about Jenkins. The target audience of these tutorials are beginners who are here to learn about Jenkins and not about how difficult Docker is. So let's see how they will perform a tutorial after this project. For example, let's say build a Java app with Maven tutorial. After this project, they will only need to clone the repo and use the previous init script with an argument Maven. Next slide, please. And that's it. Their whole setup is running with the containers are running with custom Jenkins agent image made for running Maven tutorial. And Jenkins can be accessed on localhost 8080. Next slide, please. And yes, everything works with Gitpod with just a click. Next slide, please. Okay, let's see if everything I've talked about actually works. Let me share my screen. Can you guys see me?
Yeah, yes. We can see your screen.
Okay. So this is our this is the repository that we are working on. You can check it out. This is the Gitpod button. Let's see if it works. While the Gitpod workspace is building, let me show you the original documentation that is right now present. So this is a tutorial. And these are the steps that a user needs to do just for running Docker with Jenkins for Docker. Okay, so this is where the main tutorial starts from. And all the above steps are just starting Jenkins for Docker. Let's see if Gitpod is running. Okay, Gitpod is running. Let's use the script with Maven argument. Right now, it's building the Docker image because it uses custom Docker images. Let me walk you through the tutorial. This tutorial, first step of the tutorial is to fork a repository, this repository for the tutorial. I have already forked the repository and because of the time constraints. And next step of the project tutorial is to create a custom Jenkins files and commit it to the local repo that is cloned from the official. And push the Jenkins file to it. The tutorial has four steps. It separately commits the four stages of the Jenkins files. I have already committed all the four steps because of the time constraint, and we'll see if it works or not. Okay, the Gitpod is ready. Let's see our containers that are running. Okay, our Jenkins is ready. Let's log in with the default credentials. As you can see, the agent is connected, and we also added a default job for saying, let's run the tutorial. This is the first part of the tutorial. Okay, so here we select Git. And here I am using my own forked repo, and I've already pushed Jenkins file to it, so it should be ready to build now. Okay, it's building. As you can see, it's running on the agent. And we have also included the pipeline graph view plugin. Since the Blue Ocean plugin is being deprecated, we are using this plugin. As you can see, it's building third step, fourth step, fourth stage, and fourth stage is completed. As you can see, all the stages are completed. Let's get back to the slides. Can we have the slides? Okay, so what I've learned during the first half of the GSoC. So I've learned a lot of things. First is Git and GitHub best practices, how to resolve merge conflicts. I'm not perfect at it yet, but I'm learning a lot about the Jenkins file system, writing down Docker Compose files, writing shell scripts, writing Docker files, how SSH keys works, how Gitpod works, and how to write technical documentation and a lot more. Next slide, please. Okay, so what's next for the this project? What we'll be doing the second half of the GSoC? Firstly, we'll be adding more tutorials like Maven and integrating them with init script. Secondly, right now, since we are using shell script, it doesn't support Windows without WSL, which we have some ideas to work on, which we will support Windows in future. And the other big part of the project is testing of these files, Docker Compose files and scripts with GitHub Actions and eventually with ci.jenkins.io. Last part of the project will be documentation, developing concise and easy to understand documentation for new and updated tutorials. Next. Okay. If you guys have any questions.
Anyone in the panel? Thank you for your presentation, Ashutosh. Very good.
So Ashutosh, what was your previous experience with Docker? Had you already used Docker Compose before you began working with the Jenkins project? And how did you learn Docker and Docker Compose?
I mostly learned Docker and Docker Compose while preparing for the proposal. I was early for preparing for the GSoC. I was hanging around here for about three months, I think. The Jenkins community helped me a lot. I was already interested in Docker project. So a lot of mentors helped me with what should I do, how should I learn things. So it's better to start early because community will help you a lot.
Thank you. Are there other questions? Bruno, something on the wire?
I can't see any for the time being.
While we're waiting for potential questions for Ashutosh, I would like to congratulate all four contributors for the work done up to now, and also for these presentation. Not easy to do, but I think the goals were achieved and good, very good presentations. I'd also like to thank all the mentors that put a lot of time together with the mentors to reach that state. And I wish them the same enthusiasm and success for completing. Bruno, I see a little.
Yeah, it's not a question. Q&A. It's a comment from Alexander Brandes. Hello, not my fault. He'd like to thank all presenters sharing their GSoC progress and stories. He says you really make a difference to Jenkins and the community. Thank you, Alex.
Alex summarized it very well.
Thank everyone, the Jenkins community, and especially the mentors who spend so much of their time and effort with me and helped me learn so much.
And Aaron says, applause to everyone. Great job. Thanks a lot, Aaron.
Yeah, I think up to now, we have a great 2023 edition of GSoC. So, Elissa, I think this concludes nearly on time the four midterm presentation of the four GSoC projects we have this year.
Yes, indeed. Congratulations to all of our four contributors. Well done. Good job. There's more to come. So, but there's, you know, we're still working on progress with GSoC. So if anybody's interested in next year's GSoC, we are always open and welcoming to new mentors. So we're always looking for more mentors to help us out in the project. The Jenkins GSoC website is listed there. We do host a weekly office hours. So meeting notes and recordings are also listed on the link there. Blogs and communications via our Discord and Gitter channel is also listed on this link as well. But we're hoping that new mentors and more mentors will join us next year. And for some upcoming Jenkins events where you can, you know, if you're local and you're interested in either meeting Mark or anyone else, well, some of us, just check out the DevOps World Tour. That's going to be starting in September. That's going to start in, I believe it's in New York City. But there's going to be three locations in the US, one location in Singapore, and one location in London. There will be a session on Jenkins at each of those locations. And Hacktoberfest, Jean-Marc, do you want to add this? Do you want to give a comment since you're going to be driving this program?
Yes.
You're on mute.
Am I? Well, no, it should work now. Yeah. Yes, Hacktoberfest is an activity where we encourage people with minimal experience in open source and guide them to learn how to contribute to open source project and work together with modern technology. So it means mostly remote, the good old times of getting together in one room are a little bit bygone. But Hacktoberfest will happen, as the name implies, in October. And you'll hear more about that. And I will lead the effort there and encourage people to participate. Good publicity for GSoC. Hacktoberfest is a very good school to start learning and to get the experience, what I call the Jenkins muscle, to get used how it works, to be able to have a strong and powerful proposal and maybe have a chance to be selected for next year's GSoC season. Back to you, Alyssa.
Thanks, Jean-Marc. Okay, so this concludes our session for today. Thank you everybody for joining. As I mentioned earlier, we will provide the links to the deck as well as the recording in the Meetup on the Meetup page, as well as in our Discord and Gitter channels. So if you want to meet us there, chat some more, or just take a look at, back at these recordings, you can find in those locations. Thanks, everybody.
Have a great one.
Bye-bye.
Before we close.
Yes.
Before we close, I just would like to emphasize, we had to drop projects this year because we were lacking mentors. So if you're interested to mentor projects for next year's edition, please reach out. Let's discuss that. You can also get prepared for that. But for the success of the whole program, we need mentors, so please join us. Sorry Absolutely. For that last publicity at Absolutely. The end of the presentation.
It's perfect.
Back to you, Alyssa.
All right. Thanks, Jean-Marc. Thanks, everybody. Take care.
Thank you very, very much to everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.